Yes.
Distinguished scholars, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Jackson Mwagoto, a senior lecturer at the University of Manchester. It is an honor to present this paper entitled The Globalization Laboratory, Past and Present Duplicity, Where the Shoe Pinches, at the 2009 Second Global Studies Conference hosted by the Zayed University, Dubai, UAE. It is not lost on me that the medium that I am using, YouTube, is but part of the larger landscape of technological breakthroughs, one of the aspects of this presentation, that incidentally has contributed to the liberation of transnational corporations from their previous dependence on state-controlled networks and patronage and thus cemented their preeminence. Globalization is not completely new or recent phenomenon. Rather, it is the intensification of economic, political, social, and cultural relations that have been at work for centuries. Nation-states and their authority are under threat from forces within the global economy. Although globalization is considered to be a recent phenomenon, its origins lie with the nation-state as it clawed its way to be the dominant political and economic player in the international community. Nation-states achieved their preeminence and dominance of the international community on the back of free enterprise, and now this dependence threatens its pivotal role in the global financial and trade arena. The genesis of globalization, incidentally, had its roots in yester centuries in the imperialistic and hegemonic agendas of European states. Imperialistic success was hinged on military and economic resources and the ability to guarantee control of new territory against other challenges, as well as the capacity to address and harness resources in the bid to exploit opportunities that new expanding markets offered. Nation states, realizing that private companies would assist them, created an environment conducive for them to develop and often subcontracted aspects of sovereignty, including running and managing colonies, resource extraction, and trade. This cooperation allowed nation states to flourish, but in time would lead to private trading entities that not only owed no allegiance to nation states, but increasingly were beyond their control. It is now apparent that the nation state initially came to develop a global platform for its nationalistic agendas through use of both public and private finance has in the end been caught off guard with the emergence of the fully fledged transnational corporations in the 20th century, which has now peaked in the 21st century. The advent of the 20th century and the technological advances, especially in telecommunication, marked a turning point for global trade. Technological breakthroughs liberated transnational corporations from their previous dependence on state-controlled networks and patronage. Technology has made it possible for transnational corporations to treat the entire globe as one internal market, which has severely reduced nation-states' ability to offer principled regulation of trade and commerce, as well as finance both domestically and internationally. So successful have transnational corporations been in harnessing the advantages offered by technology and the opportunities created by global trade that by the end of the 20th century, half of the top 100 economies in the world were not nation states, but transnational corporations. International trade and transnational corporations have thus evolved far beyond the simple paradigm of a national firm trading in foreign markets. Central to the global economy is the disjunction between the territorial nature of sovereignty and the increasing global nature of economic and financial flows. In short, the territorial jurisdiction of the modern state of economic life is increasingly constrained by the globalization of economic and financial relations. The emergence of a mostly private international institutional order wherein the strategic agents are not national governments, but a variety of private actors has had the effect of reducing the scope and exclusivity of the state's authority and lawmaking competence. Global deregulation of governance and regulatory regimes has had the cumulative effect of increasing the power and influence of multilateral institutions at the expense of the nation state's ability to maintain its national and traditional economic aristocracy. Globalization, though a construct of the nation-state, has outgrown the nation-state and enslaves national sovereignty to economic interests, both domestic and foreign, thus disaggregating the nation-state and breaking the Westphalian triangle of people, territory, and government. relating the notion of freedom from external interference to contemporary developments in the global economy, transnational conglomerates, which are not limited by national borders, indeed do not owe any national allegiance, have combined with technical and technological innovations to forge forces that now seriously challenge the authority of many nation states. The phenomenon of globalization seems not only to ignore national sovereignty, but appears to be immune from the actions of nation states and their attempts at regulation. Despite the role that the state retains in regulation of the economy, mainly the national economy, we are seeing a repositioning of the state in a broader field of power, with global forces reconfiguring the work of nation states. This broader field of power is partly constituted through the formation of a new private institutional order linked to the global economy, but also through the growing importance of a variety of other institutional orders. The nation state is now forced to participate in the very process that it helped to create as a partner with private companies, as epitomized by current efforts to address the global financial and trade meltdown. Distinguished scholars, ladies and gentlemen, I will conclude my presentation at this juncture with this note. People understand disease, poverty, and science. The majority of the citizenry of the world, from the farmlands of Africa to the export processing zones of Asia and the industrial belts of North America, do not understand a global trade and financial meltdown. How reassuring it would have been if the leaders of the world's leading economies had come out of the recent G20 summit hosted in London, minus prompts, auto cues, and phlegm, and told the world in convincing terms that all was going to be well. When policy has failed at the national level and ignited a pernicious drift towards global dystopia, it seems we are left only with the rhetoric of political leaders and the hollow assurances of corporate heavyweights that corporate excesses and government regulatory failure can be addressed, and hence a return to global utopia. Thank you.